Good evening. I'm Colonel Rob Cookook. I have the honor of being the Dean of the College of National Services, along with my duties of being the Professor of Naval Science here at Norwich University. And tonight, it's our great honor to host one of the Navy's few four-star admirals to come and be our guest speaker at this event of the Todd Lecture Series. As some of you know, the Todd Lecture Series is named in honor of retired U.S. Army Major General and Norwich President Emeritus W. Russell Todd, Norwich Class of 1950, and his late wife Carol, in gratitude for their dedicated service to Norwich University and the Northfield community at large. Founded in 2008, the Todd Lecture Series is made possible by a generous donation from Ellen and John Drew, the Todd's daughter and son-in-law, and the Drew Foundation. This lecture series will always be free and open to all Norwich University students, alumni, and as well as the greater Vermont, Central Vermont community. We're very fortunate this evening to have Major General Todd with us. If I can ask him to please stand and be recognized and be welcomed back to his alma mater here at Norwich University. Also, we're very fortunate this evening, as many of you know, that some of our distinguished alumnus general officers and flag officers visit in our classrooms today. If I may, I'm going to name those individuals that joined us in our classes, that took time out of their busy schedules to come and join us and give a little bit back to the university itself. If I could ask that when I call your name, if you could stand, we'll hold our applause to the end and then recognize our distinguished general and flag officers and SES individuals that are alumni of the university. Lieutenant General Michael Duby, Major General Cedric George of the U.S. Air Force, Major General Gary Keefe, U.S. Air Force, Mr. David Merker of the Senior Executive Service, Brigadier General Raymond Deschanel, United States Marine Corps, Rear Admiral Daniel McDonnell of the United States Navy, Brigadier General Jeffrey Farnsworth, United States Army, Brigadier General Peter Lambert of the United States Air Force, and Brigadier General Paul Fredenberg of the United States Army. Ladies and gentlemen, our distinguished alumni from Norway. And for the main event this evening, we're very, very fortunate to have with us Admiral Phil Davidson, who's a native of St. Louis, Missouri, and he's the current commander of the United States Fleet Forces Command based in Norfolk, Virginia. He mans, trains, and equips over 125 ships, 1,000 aircraft, and 103,000 active duty personnel and civilian members of the United States Navy. As a commander of the U.S. Fleet Forces, he's responsible for providing combat-ready forces forward to our numbered fleets and our combatant commanders around the world, always in support of the interests of the United States. His past assignments, he has commanded the United States Navy's 6th Fleet, Carrier Strike Group 8, Eisenhower Strike Group, the USS Gettysburg, and the USS Taylor. It's my great pleasure this evening to introduce to Norwich Admiral Davidson.
Good evening, everyone. President Schneider, thank you for inviting me. I appreciate it very, very much. President Emeritus Todd, lending your name to this series, I want everybody to know in the room that President Schneider tried to pressure me just a little bit with some of the speakers who have been here in the past. Mentioned Colin Powell's name, Condoleezza Rice, Chief Staff of the Army, Mark Milley, just several months ago, I think. In my mind, I was thinking to myself, well, yeah, okay, that's pretty good company. I appreciate the invitation. But I remember sitting out there. I'm a Naval Academy graduate. In our day, we had a similar series, this one much more fortunately named. In my day, it was the Forrestal Lecture, named after a former Secretary of Defense, and an aircraft carrier was named after him. Of course, to the midshipmen, it was known as the Borisol question. And I want to be sure not to do that tonight, so I'll try not to go on too long. Now, I understand I'm here between a couple of big events. So the first was spring break, right? We have spring break last week. Where's the cadet that went to Bermuda? Stick up your hand. I saw you earlier today. Come on. All right, I was going to say, President Schneider, judgment, A, going to Bermuda up here right before the snow. Very good. And I understand the Frozen Four for Division III is this weekend. Is that right? Very good. So Norwich versus Adrian. I know very much who we're going to cheer for. Okay. All of my briefings and lectures begin with a quiz. Army. Intended Army and former Army and current Army. Let's hear it. Air Force. Yeah. United States Marines. Yeah. Navy. Yeah. Okay, I've got a pretty good sense of the room here. All right, now, not all of you will join the Navy, of course. I am the fleet commander. I'm the lead fleet commander. That's what that man train and equip business means. And that's obviously what I'm here to talk to you a little bit about tonight. Maybe not all of you will be in the Navy, but maybe some of you will change your mind. Okay, more quiz. How many cadet officers and where are they? Stick up your hands so I can see kind of, they're everywhere. Okay, cadet NCOs. All right, cadet corporals. And the rooks no more. Cadet privates, where are you? Very good. Congratulations, ladies and gentlemen. Where are the traditional students? Are there a few? All right, very good, right here in the front. Okay, this has been a big day. GOFO Day, as the front office called it. General officers and flag officers here to talk about leadership. I met with the Navy ROTC unit and some others earlier today. Many of the questions were about leadership. How do I lead? And I want to talk to you a little bit about that today. Your experience, the cadets, is somewhat parallel to mine in my Naval Academy experience. Rook Week, we had a plebe summer. Rook Knowledge, we had a thing called Reef Points. Dog River Run, Square Meal, Squaring Your Corners, all the discipline that went in before your recognition here just a short time ago. During your rook year, indeed your freshman year for the traditional students, nothing is really yours, not even time. You are cut out from the outside world, and life seems a bit, well, overwhelming, especially at the beginning. Fair enough? After that, that's when the real challenge and growth begins. The next 3 years you'll do, and then should many of you elect to commission, what you do after commissioning. And that was at the heart of the questions that I answered today. Now, 3+ more years of academics, more athletics, more lectures, parades, failures and successes, the ups and downs, the good and bad, the sum of the experience is going to be greater than the individual events. Together, it all forms you well for the challenges that you will await after your commission. After all, you have a good example here in Norwich. You have a guidon. It is the honor code. And I want to spend a minute talking about that today. Who's wearing their ring? Hold it up. What does it say on the side that never changes? Honor. Words have meaning. They're an etymology, right? What does honor mean? Honor is defined by Webster's, a keen sense of ethical conduct. That's only part of the definition, okay? I think you all have that sense of what that takes. It's a keen sense of ethical conduct, colon, integrity. What does integrity mean? Webster's, a firm adherence to a code of especially moral or artistic values, an incorruptibility. It's very important. We're talking about this a little bit at dinner today. There's a second definition of integrity. It means wholeness or completeness. Are you sound? When you talk about it in the sense of a vessel, a ship at sea, if it's not holed, H-O-L-E-D, that vessel has integrity and is able to go forward. You probably have never thought about it, but that definition, artistic or, excuse me, moral or artistic value, is important. The artistic value you should have. Midshipmen, excuse me, cadets do not lie, cheat, or steal, or tolerate those that do so. What is our artistic value? In the Navy, it's making the fleet ready to fight and win. It's the mission. We have an artistic value. So when we look at Webster's definition of integrity, we should be thinking about it in terms of moral and artistic value. And even though it may seem abstract, your entire team, time here at Norwich prepares you to become junior officers leading in the fleet. And I'm going to have some examples for you today. They must be imbued with the highest sense of honor and integrity. As I reflected on my own experience at the Naval Academy, I realized the challenge that awaits you upon commissioning and becoming a junior officer, or going into service, service of your local community, your business, your state, your country going forward. The real challenge isn't the unknown. What you don't know is going to happen from your college experience. That's not the challenge at all. The challenge is to be a person of integrity, to be complete or whole going forward. That second definition of integrity is what it takes. You must understand, to have that integrity, that it must be exhibited on the outside. So often when you ask a young person, what does integrity mean? They say, doing right when no one's looking. It's actually doing right when everyone is looking. And that's going to be the key change in your experience going forward. Up until this point, your sense of you has been about your personal interests and accomplishments. If you consider the challenge you are about to undergo, you'll realize that life as a junior officer will be more than just you. Don't mistake me. I'm not saying you won't have personal accolades or a personal life. I'm simply saying that your objective is going to be that unit and whatever element of that organization that you lead going forward. Now, that's a real challenge. How do you address the external perception of the personal? How will you deliver success when you personally are not the only variable in the equation? How do you do it when others are having a bad day, a bad week, or a bad year? How will you manage the time, the effort, and the performance of a whole litany of people above and below you, and not just you, which is what you've been doing here in college? Your major, your GPA, your service assignment. To help you as you make that transition, whether it is in a few months for those seniors or a couple of years, let me offer some advice. Advice that will help you not only be successful, but facilitate others' success and the completion of the mission. There are three simple rules for you to follow as you step into the very wide world as a leader of integrity. Rule one, it is indeed about the mission. That's what we go into the service for. It's simple. Your service, your organization is not about you. It is about the mission readiness of your unit or team. The Navy's mission is 14 wonderful words in Title 10 of the U.S. Code. To be prepared to conduct prompt and sustained combat incident to operations at sea. Whenever I'm having a dark day, whenever I'm feeling a little vague as to what my purpose is that day, I can zero in on that mission and it helps me prioritize my own work for the day. If you want your chain of command's respect above and below you, then you have to give the mission of your service or organization your respect and your support. If you think your time is better spent in other aspects of whatever it is you're about to do while you're in working hours, your head is not in the wrong place. And your people, the people you're trying to lead in this organization, will sniff it out. And you will not garner their respect. Ultimately, you will garner neither the accolades nor the positions that accrue to successful junior officers either. Nothing in your resume, your educational background, your previous combat record, your good looks, and yes, even your money, none of it will overcome an inattentive, uncaring about the mission, or self-centered junior officer tour. It's the way to the future. So, rule number one, it's all about the mission. Rule two, you must communicate. The mission that I just described requires supervisors and subordinates alike to pull together as a team to be successful on the mission and in combat, certainly. To do that, we must understand up, down, and across the chain of command the limits and advantages of the command and your piece of it, the risks involved in the command's intended actions, everyone's role and what they and their duties and how they intend to deliver them, and then collectively that team must deliver success. The only way to deliver that understanding is to communicate, and not just down the chain. Clear communications are required up the chain of command, and indeed across the chain of command in order for all of us to be successful. Every one of us in every command and in every branch of the military depends upon the clear communication of others in order to carry out their duties and deliver success. It is the only way we can develop shared understanding, the trust and teamwork necessary to carry out our duties. And part of that is you must communicate what you know to be factual and true. It's a difficult task. Many of you moving out there as junior officers, it'll be new. Much of what the United States Navy does, many of you will have spent perhaps 3 weeks or a month on a ship before you get to that first ship, and you're wondering what that expectation is. I want you to think about it. Clear communications are required up and down the chain, I said, and across, in order for all of us actually to be successful. A destroyer captain depends on the proper reports of his deck officer in order for him to understand the surface traffic picture around him, and ultimately the safety of the ship. An aviation electronics technician, way down the chain of command, depends upon the clear communications of a logistics specialist in another tribe in the organization as to what the availability of a part might be in order to determine whether that jet will be up or down for its mission. A submarine captain relies on the underlying reports from first and second checkers that the ship is indeed rigged for dive in order for him to give it the order to submerge. So it's very, very important. Whether you are an introvert or extrovert, you have to find the courage to communicate with your subordinates, with your peers, and with your superiors. Tied to that is rule number three. Have some empathy for your subordinates, of course, and we'll come back to that, but also for your fellow junior officers and your leadership as well. Why do I say that? My favorite saying of all time is, my problem isn't the same as the boss's problem, even though it looks like the same problem. Now, what is empathy? I'm going to depart from Webster's. In Webster's, I'll give you Davidson's interpretation. Empathy means, oh my God, what happened? What can I do for you to help? I'm here to help you. Sympathy means, stinks to be you. There's a difference between those two things. You need to pull up and have some empathy. Look, at the end of the day, you're not going to know what your boss's problems are, for example. How he or she is getting along with their own boss, whether he or she is distracted by the myriad of things that they're responsible for, which exceed your own duties. They are just not responsible for you and what happens to be on your mind at that moment. So I expect you to give that leadership the benefit of the doubt. Help them with the facts, what you know to be true, what I said in the communications. Do not assume that your leaders have everything in hand, even if they have invited you to stay out of it. But you gotta be smart about it. You have to be courageous about it. You have to be smart about it. Think about it. Your CO in just about every organization has to be right 100% of the time. In the Navy, they're responsible and accountable for their unit 24/7, 365, even when they're sleeping. At some point, is it inevitable that your commanding officer is going to be wrong? Now, have you built the kind of relationship with the CO that will let you help him or help her be right 100% of the time? Does the CO know you to be trustworthy, communicative, aware of the standard operating procedures and the facts and able to get the job done and supportive enough of the mission to know that they'll listen to you. They'll listen to that forceful backup that you provide. Does the CO know that you're committed to rules 1 and 2, mission and communications? An exceptional JO will have the empathy for others on his or her ship in a way that will help facilitate everybody's success. The same is true of those who work for you, your subordinates. Everyone is entitled to a bad day. Will you be empathetic, helpful, and understanding of that subordinate when they are not up to the task that day? There is a difference between a bad day and willful disobedience or disregard for standards and convictions. George Washington even wrote about when he was a commander in chief. In my experience, and despite what you might think, superiors are incredibly forgiving of their JOs when they have a bad day. You as JOs need to be incredibly forgiving of your troops when they have a bad day. You must be the same for your folks. Again, the secret to that is communication. Make sure you get to the bottom of it. I'm not just talking about someone having a problem at home either. I'm talking about a mistake with the gear, a professional error or shortcoming. You will solve those problems and be empathetic if you communicate with them and if they know, you're also committed to the mission and communications and their organizational interests. So, 3 simple rules. It's about the mission. You're going to have to communicate up, down, and across the chain of command, and you must have some empathy. If you remember those 3 rules, you'll help your team be successful. Their success becomes your success. I said at the beginning, your success is no longer a personal one. It's going to be a professional one. Your success will be derived from the success of others below you and up the chain. One does not happen without the other. That is the essence of being a naval officer and a professional, by the way, in any business. It is the difference between your life up to now through college and what it will be as you move on to a life of service. That is the real challenge, soon to be a reality for some of you in 53 days. It's coming very, very quickly. Okay, if everything I just said has instilled some fear in you, let me reassure you that you are up to the task. Now, I was interested to know in my sessions with the ROTC unit earlier today, the Navy ROTC unit earlier today, everybody's question was, how do I lead? I've given you some thoughts to talk about that. But let's talk about some of the people that you may or may not know that are out there leading from Norwich right now. Come to the next slide. This is Lieutenant Sean Walsh. He's an SH-60 Romeo pilot. That's a helicopter in the United States Navy. He's a 2012 grad in mechanical engineering from right here at Norwich. He's originally from Clinton, Connecticut, and he's now deployed on the USS Carl Vinson, Carrier Strike Group, CVN-70. It's on deployment in the South China Sea today. Right here in this picture, it's a little washed out from where I'm standing. That's actually the mountains of Nevada and northeastern California, where he was there on a training mission. As I said, he flies SH-60 Seahawk. It's a twin-engine helicopter based aboard cruisers and destroyers that deploys sonobuoys and torpedoes in an anti-submarine role. It has numerous other capabilities. It's also capable of doing combat search and rescue and some personal recovery missions, and that's indeed what he was doing up there. Sean and his team support our highest tactical organization, and that is the Carrier Strike Group. They can go wherever and whenever the nation needs it, 24/7, 365. He's at the pointy end of the spear tonight, as we're all talking here, actually tomorrow, in Western Pacific time. And he's executing one of the nation's most important missions in a delicate area in the South China Sea. Next slide, please. This is Lieutenant Erica Plumador, also the class of 2012. She majored in communications right here, and she's a native of Yorktown, Virginia. She's here operating a ship's weapon system during interactions with Iranian surface combatants as a training officer on the USS Nitsa, a destroyer. And she's out there executing the mission. She just got back from deployment several months ago. She started her junior officer tour as the communications officer, responsible for communications equipment and some of the most highly classified material we have in the Navy and the USS Nitsa, and then fleeted up to be the training officer in her second tour. While a training officer, Erica had an incident where a sailor gun-decked, that means falsified the proof that they actually did some maintenance on some equipment, on some damage control gear, because he didn't understand the check. Though it was difficult, Erica had the integrity, the commitment to the mission, the artistic value, I gotta make this unit ready to fight and win, and the moral integrity to stand up and make sure that she corrected that behavior. Very clearly communicated that standard to that sailor and throughout her division, and in this instance, it had a direct impact on the safety of the ship and crew. She's coming up on the end of her second tour here on the USS NHTSA, and she's been assigned to the Naval Special Warfare Mission Support Center in Coronado, California. And she was recently selected for the Navy's Law Education Program. She'll start law school just this fall. So she had the skills that printed on the side of her ring and the benefit of the education here at Norwich, and she's out there leading in the fleet. The next slide is Lieutenant J.G. Jonathan Bermudez Mendez. He's a surface warfare officer. He's a graduate in 2013 in history. Born in Ponce, Puerto Rico, and raised in Bristol, Connecticut. He also served as a communication officer in a different ship, the USS Donald Cook, another destroyer. Today, he is the anti-submarine warfare officer in charge of sonars and torpedoes on board the USS San Jacinto, a cruiser that just returned from deployment as well. His most recent mission, this was in December, tracking and monitoring real-world Russian submarines in the Mediterranean, clearly at the pointy end of the spear. He learned quickly during his first sea tour how effective communication can lead to success. He listened and learned from his senior enlisted and was trained in the art of clearly identifying paths to success and the paths required to overcome barriers, and there will be barriers presented to you. This lesson would be put into action during this second sea tour on Sanjak. When met with the challenges during the start of the Sanjak, his tour is on the San Jacinto, he quickly recognized what needed to be done, clear guidance, facilitated with his own clear communication, instrumental in turning an average division into an effective fighting team, and all the while increasing the overall combat effectiveness and to team cohesion required for mission success. He plans to attend the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California here in just a few months to get a Master's of Science degree in Operations Research, another Norwich grad leading in the fleet. Slide, please. This is Lieutenant Audrey Collier. She's originally from Warren, Mass. Audrey's first tour was in the USS New Orleans, an amphibious transport dock designed to deliver a fully equipped battalion of 700 Marines. It recently deployed to the Arabian Gulf. She's been successful in her tour, and she attributes this as well to effective communications up and down the chain. As a young surface warfare officer, she quickly learned the value of clearly articulating the mission, the function, the tasks that were associated with those. She was often faced with challenging scenarios, running a division of 50 sailors in austere environments at sea, forward deployed, and by the end of her tour, she was known for her open and clear communication with superiors and subordinates alike. She's so good at that. We recognized her for a new program that we have in the Surface Warfare Navy. She's in training to become an Advanced Mine Warfare Tactics Instructor, WTI, what we call a WITI, at the Surface and Mine Warfighting Development Center in San Diego. She'll be a special instructor, certified to train across the fleet people of all ranks in mine warfare tactics. That only comes the best of the best. The next slide, Lieutenant Sean Scales. He's a surface warfare officer as well, graduated here in 2012 with a degree in electrical engineering, and he's from Sterling, Virginia. Sean served two tours in the USS Donald Cook as strike officer and fire control officer. During four deployments in the Mediterranean Sea, the Black Sea, and the Baltic Sea, he was aboard Cook, and he also led his team in seven major certifications in preparation for national tasking. You got it. He had to be all about the mission. The ships that are forward deployed in Rota, of which the Donald Cook is one of them, is essentially on call 24/7, 365. And it takes a special breed of cat to do that. Sean learned when he got to a ship that even though he was younger and less experienced than those he was leading, each and every one of them looked to him for the division's success, and he got it. He knew that his success would only be based on their success. He attributes this to understanding the notion of empathy that I described to you. You see, when you weave it all together, you have to look at the circumstances with the big picture in mind, the big picture in mind and not just through the lens of you, what's on your plate, how you're feeling that day. You must always think about the organization as a whole with the end, the mission in mind. Today, Sean is at the Naval Postgraduate School in Monterey, California, and he's working on his Master in Business Administration and Financial Management. Now, I know for a fact that each one of these officers would not hesitate to echo what I've told you about the challenges that lie ahead. They all have stories that reinforce the expectations of the mission, the communications that are required to deliver on it, and the empathy it takes to lead. Today, they know firsthand what it means to fight and win. And make no mistake about it, that fight is not some glorious moment in the spotlight. It's executing their day in, day out duties, what I call the grind. Putting the uniform on every day, plunging into the line and doing the hard work it takes, getting the unit ready for that unknown moment. The sign at the main entrance of your campus says, "Let those who pass through this gate know that they have become part of a long and venerable tradition of excellence and service." That is absolutely true. I'm witnessing it right in the fleet. And whether you serve for 4 years or you serve for 40 years, Norwich is helping you with the tools and the excellence and is sending you on your way with a gift imprinted with a word on the side to help you remember the basis in which you will approach your service. So I want to recognize and say thank you to the staff and the faculty here at Norwich that they work so hard to make all this possible. Indeed, your efforts are crucial in the development of future leaders. I'm at the far end of the product line, and I'm grateful for what you're producing here. So cadets and students, remember what I told you here tonight, and it will serve you well in the future. I wish you all the best this weekend in the big hockey game against Adrian, and all your remaining days here at Norwich, and especially as junior officers leading in the fleet. We look forward to seeing you out there. Okay? Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thank you. Please. All right, I have a coin for the first question. It's just to get him going. Go ahead.
Good evening, sir. Thank you very much for coming. My name's Jonathan May. I'm a junior here studying electrical and computer engineering. Over this past summer, I had the great opportunity to work for General Dynamics, who does a lot of contracting with the Navy. Mm-hmm. So my question is where are you looking to see the next big technology change in the Navy, whether it be unmanned underwater vehicles or a new submarine?
Yeah. There's a lot of technologies that we're bringing to the fore right now. So if you recall, just in the last couple of years, we flew an unmanned aerial vehicle on and off the carrier several times. That was a prototype system that we were examining. We are experimenting with a large displacement underwater, unmanned underwater vehicle right now as well. If you're asking about the next thing, running those unmanned vehicles in a rather large proliferation of them is the next level of work that we have to get accomplished there. You've probably read, you know, we're doing some pretty good things with small swarming aerial vehicles right now. The thing that has captured my attention, captured my attention in the very near term is energy weapons. Whether it's a rail gun or a laser, we've kind of had to go backwards on our power generation and what I call power wrangling. We generate a lot of power in a ship. We've just produced a new ship called the DDG-1000, the Zumwalt, which makes 10 times the power that we make, I'm talking electrical power, that we make on a regular DDG. So wrangling that power to drive electric drive motors and wrangling it so that we can pulse it for a laser, or pulse it for a railgun takes a lot of work. So there's a little transformational experimentation, you know, development going on to get to that next level. I don't think I'll see it in my lifetime in the Navy. I do know I'll see it in my lifetime, however. Fair enough?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Over here.
Good evening, sir. My name is Derek Letito. I'm a Navy ROTC senior here at Norwich. And my question has to do a little bit of what you talked about earlier during MILAB with the Navy ROTC unit.
Yeah.
You spoke about the threat of the 4+1.
Yeah.
How each of them has greatly increased their capabilities lately, particularly China. And I know that since basically the collapse of the Soviet Union, the United States Navy hasn't faced a significant threat at sea. We've basically been able to go around as we please without a significant threat. And recently I had the opportunity to hear the CNO speak at the Notre Dame Leadership Conference, and he spoke about us getting back to sea control and being able to deal with the contested contested waters and on the blue waters. How do you feel that the current fleet is able to begin operating in that way again in contested environments?
Okay, so a lot to unpack there. The important thing to remember is the United States Navy, as I expect every service is they must be what the nation needs them to be at the time and space that they need them to be. And in the post 9/11 environment, the nation needed the Navy to be a more littoral, coin, constabulary focused organization. To develop those skills at a time when we took 57,000 people out of the United States Navy, almost 20% of the force, a little less, 15% of the force, to create that force, put people in green, more EOD, more construction battalion engineers, expeditionary construction, more human intelligence teams, that kind of stuff, required us to take some efficiencies out of accounts that we would have preferred not to in the day. I mean, you know, this is the hard work that leadership does. I can't fault them for it. I didn't have their budgets, didn't have their mission. One of the areas in which we took some risk, sea control. What is a sea control fight? For those of you who don't know, it's ship-on-ship battle at sea. So some of the long-range surface-to-surface missiles that we could have developed in that time frame, some of the protections and defenses against those kind of things, we weren't buying that, and we were buying these other things. So we are blank bent for leather to get after that now. The discussion that you've seen coming out of Washington is there, we want to make readiness right first. We want to make holdness right. That means, you know, make sure that the missions that all the services are indeed responsible for are sound. We're trying to ramp up that sea control investment. And it's not just money. It's technology, but it's training, it's time, it's people, all those things to make that happen. We're getting after it in a hurry. We've made a lot of changes in the last 2 years. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
You bet. Over here.
Good evening, sir. Ian Stevens, Air Force ROTC. In his confirmation hearings, Secretary Mattis said that the best way to improve our military's readiness was to increase funding for the State Department so we didn't have to fight wars. But in the President's budget request, the State Department's budget was cut by 28%. How do you think that'll affect the readiness of the United States military and our capability to fight wars in the future?
Clearly, we, you know, I think just about all of us in the military, particularly those who have served on the battlefield the last 15 years, recognize the value of a whole-of-government approach. And these investments are critical to a lot of countries around the world. It helps hold down the instability that burdens up out of a number of places. As always, the Executive Department proposes and the Congress disposes. It's a conversation that's ongoing. I have every confidence they'll get to a good place on this.
Thank you, sir.
Good catch. There's only 1,500 people watching. Oh!
Everybody in this room. All right.
Go ahead.
Good evening, Admiral. My name is Midshipman First Class Stephen Cabral. And tonight we talked a lot about what you should do as a leader and as a junior officer. Colonel Cook likes to tell our unit, or likes to talk about keeping a little black book titled Things That I Would Change If I Was in Charge. So I'm curious, sir, do you keep one? And if you do, or if you were to keep one, if I were to look into it when you were a JO, what mm-hmm. would I find? And if I were to look into it right now, what would I find?
I think, you know, I'll answer the second part first. If you wanted to know what I was like as a JO, I was every bit as passionate and focused as I am now when I'm on the job. That's not to say that I'm a curmudgeon, though. You know, I have a life and a family and all those things as well. So I've been pretty pleased that I've got a pretty close family, and my children are far older than you are. Pretty pleased I got a pretty tight family all these years later when they're young adults. As for a keeper of a book, so let me put it this way. My staff, I've been at my headquarters for 27 months now. It's in a lot of ways my most favorite job ever. They asked me what I expected out of legacy out of this. And here's what I told them. I said, listen, I'm not expecting legacy out of this. What I'm expecting to inculcate is process and analysis, so that whatever challenges some subsequent commander has to me has a staff that can help him think through those challenges and make those come about. That's truly what it is. I am not a big cult of personality guy. You know, we lead from a basis of integrity. We don't lead because of a basis of personality. You know what I mean? And if you can rally the troops around the construct that I talked about, and running a headquarters, you have to put in place analysis and process so that you're not dealing with somebody's, oh, my heartfelt conviction from 1993 was this, and therefore I'd like it to be that. The strategic situation may require something else. There's no doubt in my mind that policy that I've put in place, or training, some of the training investments and apparatus that I've put in place, some future commander is going to have to change it. In fact, I'll be unhappy if he doesn't, or she doesn't. Fair enough?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you.
You gotta walk over here. They told me not to walk in front of the mic. Here, over here. Thanks. Okay.
Good evening, sir. Thank you for coming. My name is Michael Walton. I'm a freshman in Navy ROTC. And I was wondering, sir, what has been the most difficult leadership situation that you faced out in the fleet, and what did you do to overcome it?
In many ways, the most difficult leadership challenge I have right now is dealing with an integrity problem that's been going on out in the Pacific for the last 12 or 15 years. It's not endemic across the whole of the force by any means, but there was a small cadre of folks that were doing wrong, total lack of integrity, both on the mission side, the artistic value that we're trying to inculcate, and the moral side to make that happen. It's most frustrating. I've been charged with a duty that I can't talk about too much, but to help the Navy think through those ethical and regulatory violations that the Justice Department is not dealing with. The way to think about it is the integrity of the service is more important than any one of those individuals in this process. And I've got an obligation to protect, and it's taken up a lot of my time. Fair enough?
Yes, sir.
All right. Nice to meet you. Okay.
Good evening, sir. My name is Cadet Adam Souza. And my question is in regards to the recent change in administration and how that is going to affect the future of the Navy, and also how that's going to affect junior officers that are going to graduate from Naval Academy and Navy ROTC, and once they get into the fleet.
What's the question?
What type of changes do you foresee in the future of the Navy?
In terms of
weapons, structures, so on and so forth.
Yeah, certainly the administration has made clear, and our own analysis has shown, and a long conversation with the American people, Congress people, on the Hill over the course of about 21 months now has led us to the conclusion that we need a bigger Navy. That's more than just more ships. It's more ships, it's more airplanes, it's more people, it's some readiness structures and things like that. It's a tall order. And how you get there and what you buy is a pretty important conversation to have. Shipbuilding is a bit of a tedious thing. It takes 4 to 5 years to build an aircraft carrier. If you're going to propose a disruption in what you might build, you're going to wait a long time to get that, 10 or 12 years. So it has to be a very thoughtful approach about how we might go after that. There's a lot of things that have to come together in order to get a bigger Navy. And the American people, Congress, and the administration, they're having that discussion right now. It's going to be a few months until that gets resolved. Once that gets resolved, we'll know what the way ahead is. Okay?
Yes, sir.
All right. All right, next up.
Good evening, sir.
That's your question.
I'm Midshipman Fourth Class Dame Watkins. My question is, how often or have you, in your career as an officer, did you see seemingly bad situations become unexpected blessings?
Become unexpected blessings. Okay, I'll give you one. All right, let me tell you all. Life is a journey, okay? You are going to get orders. Even if you only serve for 4 years, you're probably going to have two sets of orders in there. If they don't meet your satisfaction, the best thing to do, you know, before you execute them, by orders I mean, you know, transfer to a new posting. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. My wife liked to tell me up until about 15 years ago that I never got a set of orders that I liked. Every one of them turned out to be a blessing. Some of it seemed more random than I might have expected at the time. There were a couple of assignments in which I thought I was better than what they were offering. It all turned out okay. Not because of where I am, but because the value it returned on that journey. Fair enough?
Yes, sir.
Take life as it comes. It's not a destination somewhere. Please enjoy the experiences that you get along the way, okay?
That's it.
All right. Thanks for your question. All right, next up.
Good evening, sir. My name is Kyle McClory. I'm a senior history major in the Army ROTC department. So earlier tonight, President Schneider has talked about university being a leadership laboratory. So Norwich University, the Naval Academy, as well as the other service academies and senior military colleges, they pride themselves on developing leaders, but they're first and foremost institutions of higher learning. So my question to you is, sir, how has academics played an influence on your leadership style?
Academics?
Yes, sir.
The analysis part has gotten more important as we get older, right? To understand what your own capability set, let's just speak tactically for a minute, force on force. To understand what your own capability set is, you do have to do the science, technology, engineering, and math to actually figure out what it is that you're going to produce, buy, what's achievable, you know, physics, because you can't break the laws of physics. It's got to meet that standard. But then to evaluate the utility of it against enemy threat profiles, and let me tell you something, everything has a vulnerability. There's no getting around that. But to have the courage to do that evaluation honestly, objectively, with analysis, and then to be able to step back from that and have the courage to make the decision, even though that might break somebody's rice bowl, is really, really important. One of the things I tell my staff all the time is the only person on the staff that gets to have heartfelt conviction is me. Everybody on the staff's got to bring me the facts and the analysis to tell me where we're going, or some, whether it's a tactical thing, an investment piece, operational use, that kind of thing. So try to be objective about these things going forward. There will be things that you believe are the situation, even down at the tactical level, meaning the unit level. But unless you know the facts to be true, you're kind of hunting and guessing. And you've got to be in search for the facts. All right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. That's a good question.
Good evening, sir. I'm Cadet Ford Class Full, first year Air Force ROTC Cadet, Studies in War and Peace major. We face a large amount of threats to include Russia and China. Would you consider their militaries, more specifically their naval and air forces, to be so-called paper tigers? And which one do you believe is the greater threat, sir?
The asymmetric advantage the United States has is all of you. The task that we keep giving our young people and particularly our non-commissioned officers in the Navy, you know, the E4 to E7 range, and certainly the O1 to O4 range, we routinely give them challenges that their educational basis and upbringing is able to attack. When we invite the Chinese to our own ships, for example, and they see our petty officers, our mid-grade enlisted, they go, yeah, we can't do that. We don't know how to get there. So there's probably a generation away from solving that problem. The Russians, built on the old Soviet model, have long had that issue. It's a problem for them. At the end of the day, if we had the same ships and we had United States Navy sailors on one and Chinese on the other, the people would be the difference on the same ship. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
All right. Thanks. All right, next. I'm going to run out of coins.
Good evening, Admiral. You spoke to this a little bit in your speech beforehand, but I find that most in ethics decisions and moral dilemma examples and situations that we often test ourselves in, people find themselves stuck between that empathy and a sense of loyalty to their people and the rule book. And they seem to be kind of swinging between there and stuck between a rock and a hard place in some sense of the phrase. So is there a particular set of rules or a tool that you've used in those situations that has kind of guided your hand in dealing with those particular moral dilemmas?
Well, I spoke to that to some extent. I mean, you're asking me to comment on a generalization. Okay. You know, do you have something more specific than that? If you want to talk about it privately afterwards, I'm happy to have a conversation with you.
Admiral, we had the example of at the Notre Dame Leadership Conference I was able to attend, and they had the example of you find one of your shipmates out drinking before a hard call of no drinking because you have to fly the next morning. But you have the option to move the flight back and allow for him to be within the 12-hour restrictions that NAVSEC is required for flight, and people would...
You're losing me.
Yes, sir.
Are they sitting in the pilot seat?
They're the NFO, sir. So NFO was drinking out, and the pilot was... You were the pilot, and you found the NFO drinking out. You have the option to move the flight back so that the NFO can fly with you, or to report him for violating the NAVSEC order.
Yeah.
So in that instance, whether they learn the lesson or not, or you still fly with them and they may risk losing the lesson.
You get somewhat hard bitten when you see execution of mission go wrong, even when the basis of that is proper and well-intentioned. We do a very, very dangerous business. Every one of these services do. You know, OSHA qualifies a flight deck on an aircraft carrier as the most hazardous environment on the planet. Yep, we have to do it 24/7, 365, and get 10 aircraft carriers to do it. As I've gotten older, it's become more and more apparent to me that the mission is everything. And you have to be able to make the hard call. Now, the judgment that goes into whether you turn this person in or just turn him out of the aircraft is two different things. And you know, sometimes that takes leadership and empathy. Somebody that lacks integrity, I better stick with that, and persistently demonstrates it, shouldn't be in the cockpit. They need to go on the street. And if you need leadership to help bring that about, they'll do it. Okay?
Yes, they will.
All right. Hard question. We're going to teach you here.
Good evening, sir.
Hi.
My name is Joseph Adams. My question is that I came from a family that was not very wealthy, and you know, making it here and you know, getting the scholarships that I was very lucky to have, what would be your advice to say that I'm coming upon hard money struggles right now? So how would I go about putting aside those struggles and coming up with a plan to where I can focus on my future and somehow achieve the dream that I want to achieve and just put all the other things aside? What advice could you give me?
There are elements here at the university that are willing to help and have these discussions with you. Have you communicated this to them?
Yes, sir, I have. You're a pretty big role model to look up to.
Well, my advice is actually to, you know, seek counsel with the folks that can help in those situations.
Yes, sir.
You spend a good, as I can remember being a junior officer, you spend a good part of your life, you know, counting the dollars and, you know, making sure that you can pay all your bills.
Yes, sir.
It does require a sense of frugality. But if you're kind of short on your objective here, you know, I hope you're engaging with the administration here to either seek the counseling that might offer you the skills to help manage your accounts, or if it's more than that, to let them know.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Who's up?
Evening, sir. Midshipman Third Class Williams. You spoke about the importance of your first tour as a DIVO and to really get your head on straight before the rest of your career. Is there anything from your first tour?
Is that earlier today you're talking about?
Yes, sir. And
yeah.
Then just from listening on a panel earlier, have you seen anything from your first tour that has stuck with you your whole career? In terms of just leadership abilities, just something that you've learned or surprised you that has stuck with you?
Yeah, one of the things that I learned along the way is you know, I talked about it a little bit here today. You know, everybody's entitled to a bad day. And if you're intolerant of other people's bad days, it's going to be kind of a miserable ride for you. You cannot attribute someone's total character to a bad day. You've got to put up with some things. In a lot of ways, it's like a marriage, right? You know, there's a lot of compromise and partnership in that whole thing. If you're going to learn anything as you move through life, you've got to be willing to see some of that other perspective and tolerate someone else's bad day. That's below you and above you as well. Fair enough?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Hi.
Good evening, sir. My question is, what do you find most rewarding in leadership?
Today, making the fleet successful in combat. I talked a little earlier to the ROTC class before. I welcomed home two groups in the last 3 months, one on the 24th of December, the WASP Amphibious Ready Group, and then the Eisenhower Carrier Strike Group came home on December 30th. A number, 10, including two actual forward deployed ships, had been in combat, direct combat, over the last period from 1 June and 1 July last year. I tell people all the time, you know, I've really got only one metric in which to measure the performance of, you know, what we're manning, training, and equipping the fleet for, and that is combat performance. That's incredibly gratifying to see that. And to see my headquarters staff hard work come to fruition at the pointy end of the spear, you know, when ships are defending themselves from cruise missiles and other aspects forward, it's pretty nice.
Good evening, sir. My name is Zachary Van Buskirk, Air Force ROTC, and my question is, what would you say was the biggest mistake you've made as a leader, and how did you overcome it?
Biggest mistake? I'm not a great sea storyteller, so I always have to hunt, you know, thinking of a sea story. I can remember being in tactical command and letting the pressure get to me in a way that was probably not kind of totally helpful for what everybody was trying to get accomplished. I was speaking earlier about a story that I had a commanding officer when I was about 8 years in the Navy. I was a department head at the time, operations officer on the frigate, and he was extraordinarily adept at dealing with things with passion but unemotionally. And that's an important factor You never know how the people that you're interacting with, whether they're above you, below you, what their upbringing was and what their fortitude might be or that. And a sharp word in the wrong moment can crush a number of spirits. So the lesson I learned from him when I was a lieutenant was if you can deal with things with passion but without emotion, it puts you in a better leadership position to inspire the troops to do what they need to do. Fair enough?
Thank you, sir.
All right.
Good evening, sir. I'm Matthew Knorr. I'm a cadet with the Civil Air Patrol program. I was wondering if there is one piece of advice or know-how that you wish that you had known before you became a junior officer.
One piece of advice before a junior officer. I can't say that I knew it before I was a junior officer, but I'll say my observation now is people are worried too far in the future about what they're going to be instead of living in the moment. This is why I say life is a journey. Make sure you take the ride and understand the value that it's returning to you. Otherwise, you can't really get to that next step, you know what I mean? If you're constantly winding your watch, waiting for a better outcome, whether you know it's coming or whether you're wishing for something to happen, it's gonna put you in a poor place emotionally. I can't say that I had that problem. I've pretty much enjoyed my life, really, in the service. It's been a great privilege. But that's my advice I give to others as they're coming up in the organization. Okay?
Thank you, sir.
All right.
My name is Edward Bowen. I'm a sophomore. My question was, what opportunities do you see for and what insight do you think that non-STEM majors can bring to the Naval Service?
The thing I like about the service, and I had a conversation about this earlier with the Navy ROTC unit, is the diverse capabilities that we bring in this, whether it's gender, ethnicity, sexual preference, academic upbringing, we need it all. And while true, the Navy is a highly technical service, and we're trying to get a lot of people that are engineers, STEM majors, that doesn't mean that we're not interested in people that can speak languages, think liberally, you know, think strategically and in a policy environment. We need all those things coming forward. So there's a place. I mean, you saw the discussion I had before: communications, history, MECI, electrical engineering. Those are the four different majors across those five people. We value all that, and they can all be successful in the Navy.
Thank you, sir.
Carr, are we out of coins? We're still going. What up?
Good evening, sir. My name is Jacob Scott with Navy ROTC, and I'd just like to ask what you believe is the most dangerous threat to the United States at sea today, as we've seen a proliferation of threats to us over the past 15 years.
Yeah. It's a pretty complex answer. I'll put it this way. The operational approach of Russia, China, Iran, even North Korea to a certain extent, even the terror, violent, extremist threat that we're doing battle with today. Their operational approach is all similar. That's to deny us our sea control. If you deny the United States Navy the sea control, the ability to get everything else to the fight, Army, Marine Corps, and in many respects, everything that the Air Force needs in terms of fuel and ordnance, if you can prevent that from happening, we don't do the power projection mission that the Joint Force does so extremely well over the last 25 years now. The tactical approach of each one of those countries, though, is slightly different. See, China's got this very robust capability, meaning high technology, capacity, numbers, lots of ships, airplanes, and an approach that's really multi-domain, bottom of the sea, all the way up into space, they want to fight. The Russians, their concern is a little more near abroad. They're more interested kind of in the areas in which they're most interested in. They don't have the capacity, the numbers. They got really good capability as well, and they also have a multi-domain approach, much higher level of kind of coastal battery approach to the Russian threat that it presents to the Navy. The Iranians have this very tactical unit, small boat, swarming, manned for the most part, some unmanned, approach to the problem. And they, you know, they want to duke it out with us in the phone booths that we sometimes have to drive through to get to where we want to be. Strait of Hormuz, the Bab el-Mandeb, places like that. So this is one of the reasons we were talking about making investments to bring up our sea control capability. If we keep that up, we keep the joint force flowing to the fight.
Good evening, sir. Tonight you've talked a lot about where JOs and other officers in the Navy have done right. But what are some things that you've seen in your career where people have gone wrong, in the military or not?
Yeah, it goes to not pushing them, putting the mission first, or it goes from a lack of integrity. You know, those without the character to be a member of a trusted member of the team, right? Some of you have read about the photo scandal that from the Marine United collective, right? It affects all the services. The kinds of characters who would denigrate other elements of the team with no good purpose, it's just not helpful to the structure of the service and what we're trying to accomplish going forward. Even under the blanket of anonymity in which they seek to protect themselves, I think that's particularly vile. If you're not willing to say, my name is, and this is what I think, you shouldn't be saying it. And I think it's a challenge we need to come to. Don't get me wrong, I don't think it's a new cultural norm that's setting the standard. I think we just need to kind of look at the basis of what we all need to understand going into this problem. And if we're people of integrity, adhering to a moral and artistic code of values, right, we'll be in a pretty good place, okay? All right.
Good evening, sir. I'm Cadet Leif Lindquist. Has there ever been a moment that you disagreed with those above you?
Sure.
And how did you overcome that? Like, how did you, I guess, push forward and accomplish the mission so you weren't at a moral conflict?
You're assuming that it has to be a moral conflict. Let me answer the first part first. Can you disagree with the orders that are given above you? If they're legal orders, you're duty-bound, because we all take an oath, to carry them out, right? The people that say, oh, you should quit over something you disagree with, more than an illegal order, we don't really put anybody in that situation, right? Or we couldn't. There's plenty of legal orders we give up where you'd go, boy, I'm not sure I want to stride into that firefight or that fire. You know, maybe I don't want to do that. You don't get to quit. You know, so the same thing happens, you know, up here at my level, if that's what you're asking me. You get a legal order, you carry it out. The moral basis, you got to have the courage to stand up to that. When you say moral basis to me, you know, they're asking to do something illegal or not consistent with the service. These challenges are not routine. They may happen once or twice, you know, in a career. You've got to have the courage to stand up to them, right? Go ahead.
Good evening, sir. My name is Cadet Minns. I'm Army ROTC here, and I'm a freshman, but I know it's a few years off. The thing I'm most nervous about post-graduation is earning the trust of the people under me if they know that I have zero experience. What would your advice be for that?
Yeah, we're gonna teach you, you know, before you get to that first unit. I was talking to Liam earlier. You know, where'd Liam go? You know, he's headed off to Fort Sill, right? Teach him artillery business, and then, you know, off to Benning and teach them then the parachute business. And we're going to deliver some of those skills to you. The thing that they're looking out for is to make sure that you're focused on the mission. Sometimes when I have this conversation with the young people, they have to understand what you believe. And if your belief set is totally misaligned with what the purpose of that unit is, you've lost them instantly. And if your actions are not aligned with producing that mission, you're going to lose them. Might you have some friends in that group? Sure. Some without the maturity to pursue the mission, unless they're led there, that might happen to you. You got to have the courage to remain focused on that, what I talked about here tonight, in order to do that. I'll tell you, everybody that comes into the service, no matter what their rank, rate, whatever, wants to be successful. And in many, many respects, most of the unit are people that are as inexperienced as you are. I tell people all the time, I walk on a destroyer, you know, 3 days away from going on deployment for 7 months, and I say, who's going on their first deployment? 60% of the hands on a destroyer will go up. There's about 300 people on a destroyer. So that means 180 people. That means 120 people have maybe done it once. There's going to be a handful of paper on there, a handful that have done it 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 times, maybe once or twice more. There won't be more than 10 people. I tell people all the time, a destroyer is like a giant schoolhouse. There's a whole bunch of people wondering what's going on, and they're looking for the guidance from people that are committed to the mission to make that happen. Okay?
Thank you very much.
All right.
Good evening, sir. Nicole Winthy. I had the opportunity to speak with you at dinner tonight about the growing social media problem that we are facing. So I just want to ask, what is your advice for the future officers that are sitting in this room on how they handle and face this issue?
Yeah, I'm very troubled by the anonymity of it all, particularly when it comes to denigrating teammates, people that they know are also in uniform. My basic rule of thumb is if you're not willing to append your name to it, or say it to someone's face, you shouldn't be saying it at all. I mean, it's just unhelpful to the team. I can tell you, I was talking about this earlier today, I believe I'm in my fourth Navy. I've been doing this for 35 years. I was in the Cold War Navy, I was in the Desert Storm and post-Desert Storm Navy, which was a big drawdown Navy. I was in the 911 and post-911 Navy. Now, I'm on this new Navy, this one that's going after the sea control fight. Just been putting this in place over the last year and a half. And I've never been more pleased with the diversity that we're bringing into the service and what it's meaning to our capability, because it is truly making us better. I wouldn't put a unit up from 30 years ago against anything I have today. Capability, locks mix. People today are better. And we just need to make sure that the approach to develop trust and teamwork and not undermine it is the thing that would be most helpful. Okay.
Good evening, sir. You were said that people have been talking about how to improve the Navy, but if the choice was yours alone, how would you spend the money and what would you do to improve the Navy?
I missed the very first part of the question. What would I do with what?
You said that people are talking about how to spend the money, and so if the choice was yours alone, where would you put the money into, and how would you improve the Navy?
Yeah, I'm in record on testimony with Congress that there are gaps in our readiness, and we have to close those accounts first. Secondly, there's a balance of what I would call wholeness, capability that we're starting to buy, but we're not buying it at a rate to actually complete a capability across either the force or a group or a squadron or a unit. We need to close on that as well. Before we have a discussion about bigger. If I had a bigger Navy with the capability shortfalls I have that have resulted from trying to transition out of this coin constabulary era into a sea control era, we won't be as good as we think we might be. So, okay?
Evening, Admiral.
My name is Cadet Anthony Trujillo. I'm a cadet in the Air Force Department. My question is, do you believe that those technical skills that you learned in your first orders have transcended throughout your change in orders and change in career fields throughout your career?
Technical skills that we said?
Yes, sir.
In the Navy, for example, the first thing that we want to teach you is how to drive a ship. And if you want to be a captain and have the confidence to teach others how to do that, that's a technical skill that you need to retain. Now, I got to tell you, the last time I was on a ship driving it, it's been a dozen years. I don't really do that anymore. Along the way of a military career, I was explaining this to the Navy unit earlier today, that first 10 years, we keep you with a tactical unit. You're going to learn, in Navy parlance, we're going to teach you how to fly that airplane exquisitely, right? We're going to teach you how to stand on the bridge of a destroyer and, you know, bring it on alongside the oiler, run the entire combat system, do all that the first 10 years. Run a nuclear reactor if you're a submariner, and then, you know, learn how to take care of the thing tactically. After about 10 years in the military service, we try to deliver other skills to every officer, mid-grade officer at that point. They might be financial management, they might be personnel management, they might be strategy, policy, resource, operations analysis, any of those things we need to make the corporation go, you know, the big strategic entity that is the service, the Air Force, to make that happen. Some people embrace it, and you need those skills to move up to positions of general officers that are here in the front row. Some people don't like it. They like to remain at the tactical level. You can have a wonderful career at the tactical level, but it is going to end sooner than this career ends. Because those skills, they atrophy. And as new technology comes in, new capability comes in, you know, it takes, and you know, some of it is physical work. It requires younger people to do it. So there's a pattern of education that's really got to happen on this whole journey. And then you make conscious decisions with the orders you're willing to put yourself up for and compete for to garner the positions of these folks in the front row. Okay?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Good evening, sir. You talked earlier about further advancement with the Navy, such as more unmanned vessels and all that. In today's world, with the cybersecurity being, or with more cyber threats coming, I was wondering if you felt the Navy was prepared to meet what could come with those, or if there's a gap that needs to be
filled. Yeah, we've done a lot of work in the last couple of years to improve the cybersecurity. Let's face it, the initial approach of everybody, industry, government, military, all that, when IT really came to the fore in terms of its capability, was, hey, we're going to live with the risk because it's a savings, because we think we can get rid of some manpower, or the capability is so advanced, it's worth the risk to sustain. Now, it's become apparent in the last, really, 10, 12 years, that the threats to everyone's cybersecurity is key. All of us, industry, military, government, are kind of forced to buy out that threat now and improve the security of our cyber networks. Will that be a threat in the future? You know, threats to the cybersecurity? Yeah, sure. Probably be for a long time. The nature of warfare is offense and defense, and you're trading that space consistently. We're pretty good at it. Others are getting pretty good at it, and we're just going to have to keep after it to stay ahead of the potential adversaries. Okay. Two more. We'll do two. Hey, come on back. We'll do two more.
Good evening, sir. I'm Cadet Thomas. I'm a freshman in the Army Department, and you spoke about communication and the importance of it. I was wondering, what are some of the biggest challenges you've faced with communication, and how have you overcome them? And when there has been a lack of communication or confusion, how have you handled that?
Part of the reason I give that advice is if you're an introvert, you've got to figure out how you're going to communicate, because you can't be successful in this business unless you can get a unit, help that unit achieve success. I said several times, help everybody else facilitate their success. You've got to find a way to communicate, even if you're introverted. You can be successful in this business. There's no doubt about it. I've seen the most senior people in the military, and they are introverts. Some of them have been, but you have to find the time and place to engage factually and be comfortable doing it, and in a way that the audience can relate to, whether it's subordinates, seniors, political counterparts, you know, across Washington, D.C., or your peers. So much of your work as a junior officer will be collaborating and coordinating with peers in order to get the situational understanding produced so that the unit is doing well. It's one of the things that really kind of takes you out of the environment here. You're good at taking tasks, you're good at showing up on time. Now you're going to be dictating that stuff. You're only going to do it through communications. Right?
Thank you, sir.
Good evening, sir. Cadet Mulvaney, Army ROTC Department. So in the Army, we say that NCOs form the backbone of our organization. Mm-hmm. Even as a junior officer, you're going to be receiving advice from your senior enlisted and other enlisted in the Army. So my question to you is, what attributes do you think make a good enlisted leader, and what can I do as an enlisted personnel to later become a better officer in my career in the military?
What attributes? The Navy has been talking about four attributes lately that I think, you know, speak to what we're trying to accomplish. And it's not just enlisted, what we want everybody. Integrity, we spent plenty of time talking about that. Another one is accountability. This is not discipline, you know, something we're trying to hold you to for. Accountability means a willingness to stand up and be counted, right? Send me, Lord. That mistake was mine. That's the kind of integrity that you want out of subordinates and superiors and all that kind of stuff. The other two are initiative. We talked a little bit about that. What is our asymmetric advantage when we talk about our potential adversaries? It's our people. And the initiative piece is the key thing that separates us from them. And the last thing is toughness. You got to be able to take a hit in this business. I would argue you also need resilience. You got to be able to recover that from as well. But right now we're focusing on that, you know, take a hit kind of stuff. When things go wrong, and things go wrong all the time, you've got to have the courage to respond to the situation. You've got to have the kind of the dispassionate approach in order to lead folks to the solution when that occurs. You can get trapped in a lot of mistakes if you're not willing to, okay, I'm going to fix this, and do it forthrightly. Okay. All right. Nice to meet you. All right. Well, listen, thank you very much, everybody. I appreciate the time here in Norwich. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Ladies and gentlemen, if I can ask you all to stay where you are, stand in place, talk amongst yourselves. I'll give you a topic. But we're going to let the Admiral and his staff depart. They have a plane to catch, and so we'll allow them to depart the gymnasium. Other than that, I want to thank everybody for joining us this evening, especially those that came from out in town. Corps, it's great questions from all of you. We appreciate it. To our GOFOs and distinguished visitors, again, thank you very, very much for taking the time to join us. And ladies and gentlemen, with that, I wish you all a good night.